Hi, I'm Nick.
And I'm Mel. I grew up playing outside.
And I grew up doing something meaningful, watching movies and TV.
I never had cable, and we finally bought a VCR about the same time DVD players hit the market.
Throughout our marriage, Mel has sadly missed many of my pop culture references and movie quotes.
So it's time to catch up on all the films I missed.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Go ahead.
Happy 4th of July.
Happy 4th of July to you.
Happy birthday, America.
Happy birthday, America. And in honor of America bucking the established political systems of its day, We are going to be bucking the established system of our podcast.
That's
tonight.
Right. Breaking the rules.
Breaking the rules like the American rebels that we are.
Please ask me the question.
So, Melissa.
Yes.
Do you know what we're watching tonight?
Yes, I do know what we're watching. Do you want to know why?
Why?
Because I picked it.
You sure did. And we voted on it. And we, again, another American staple. We voted. And what's the movie we're watching tonight?
Independence Day.
I'm assuming you've seen this movie before.
I've seen this movie, but sometimes...
Yeah.
Around the 4th of July, I really have a craving to see it again. And it's been many, many years since we've watched it.
Yeah, I think the last time we watched it was when we were in San Diego. We lived there.
In a theater showed it, and they played it. We watched it on July 2nd, which is when the movie starts.
Yes.
It was so much fun.
Yeah, it was very fun. Wow, that was when there was legit big stadium seating. Do you remember the vertical incline in that stadium seating?
Yes, it was like a huge theater.
Yeah. That was like a thing for about a decade, and then it kind of faded out to like a more subtle, gentle stadium seating. Sorry, yes. I'm getting into theater nerd mode. I love this movie.
I do too.
I'm excited that we're following the Poseidon Adventure with this movie because the Poseidon Adventure was like, you know, the birth of the big budget disaster films. Mm-hmm. And this movie is like the seminal disaster formative film of my youth. Like my teenage years. Yes, this movie was it. I was such a nerd. I even had the classical, like the score at the CD, and I would drive around with the score playing.
Yeah, we just tried listening to the score with our kids in the car on a road trip. It didn't go that great.
Yeah, can we stop playing the creepy music, Dad?
It's too intense.
It's too intense. It's like, yes, it is. It's serious stuff here.
This is not just a disaster movie, but it's apocalyptic. It's like Alien.
Oh, yeah.
It's everything you want in a 4th of July movie.
Oh, 100%.
I love it.
Also, too... Aliens have been in the news so much lately.
Yes.
So I look forward to watching this movie again, having that in my mind, because literally I see news stories about it. I kid you not, 3 to 4 times a week. So it's crazy.
So we need to watch this movie. Let's go do
it. We need to go watch it. Let's go check it out.
Listen to this.
This better not be another damn Russian spy job.
Boys from air traffic res say the skies are clear.
It's the real thing. A radio signal from another world.
Mr. President,
our intelligence tells us the object has settled into a stationary orbit. Part of it has broken off into nearly 36 other pieces. Smaller than the hull, sir. Yet over 15 miles in width themselves.
Where are they heading?
It should be entering our atmosphere within the next 25 minutes.
Earthquake!
Let's just get there as quickly as
possible.
What's
the rush, huh? Think we'll get to Washington and won't be there?
It is confirmed. The unexplained phenomenon is headed for Moscow.
It's like a chess. First, they're positioning their pieces using this one signal to synchronize their efforts.
And then what?
Checkmate.
God.
I really don't think they flew 90 billion light years to start a fight.
We gotta stop them! They're gonna kill us all!
Oh, God, I hope they bring back Elvis!
There's gonna be a lot of frightened people out there.
Yeah? I'm one of them.
Thank you.
celebrate our Independence Day.
Something you want to add to this briefing, Captain Hiller?
No, sir. Just a little anxious to get up there and whoop E.T.'s ass, that's all.
I don't think I have ever wanted our podcast to be like on video more than after having watched this movie, because after watching that movie, I always feel like that one guy when President Whitman gives his speech at the very end, like after he gives his speech, everybody's going crazy.
Yeah.
And then there's one military guy who just gives the hardest salute you've ever seen on film before. That's how you should feel after this, watching this movie.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that was awesome.
I love that movie.
I love it too, but I had forgotten so much of it.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like different people who were in it. There's a huge cast.
Yes.
There's so many people in this movie.
Yes.
And it was great. It was really great rewatching it, especially this time of the year.
Of course. It actually, I saw a whole bunch of articles kept popping up about Independence Day, the movie, because it's around the 4th of July. And apparently, like, it's become synonymous with just having a barbecue, according to the articles I read. Like, you know, you think about things to do. Think about Die Hard now, right? Every time around Christmas, you're like, oh, I got to watch Die Hard.
There's something that like turns on in your mind. Yeah. It's like when you start craving like apple pie when it's fall, it's like the same feeling. So people feel that way about Independence Day?
People are starting to, yeah. Because it has been, you know, it was 1996 is when it was released on July 2nd, right? July 2nd. That's when the movie, because it was released on the same day that the movie starts, which is just cool.
That is really cool.
It was actually the 3rd. Sorry, I was wrong. But anyway, so
it's not really cool.
No, it's still cool though. It's very cool. The bidding wars, though, there's bidding wars because people are like this. There'll be like rights for having it on your service.
Oh, right. Yeah, that makes sense.
It'll be like, you know, because it literally happened to us. We were like, oh, I dusted off my old DVD and it's from literally 1996 and it was so scratched it didn't run. So I had to look for a streaming service to show it. And anyway.
Worth it.
Worth it. Totally worth it. What you want to go? I kind of want to know if anyone listening to this has never seen this movie, because this is give us a quick summary.
Okay, so quick summary: aliens come to Earth in huge ships and land over several cities around the globe.
Huge
ships,
like 13 miles across or something like that. They're huge.
Yeah. And so Earth is left to scramble and figure out what to do. And it becomes clear very quickly that these aliens do not mean to make friends.
Yeah.
they're just here to annihilate. And so enter a whole bunch of like people who just happen to have the right skills at the right time and the right connections.
That's how it works.
To figure this out and like kind of solve the mystery of how to defeat the aliens. And they do. They defeat the aliens, and it's wonderful. So a couple things that there's so many people in this movie. Like, I had forgotten, oh my gosh, world, please forgive me. I forgot that Jeff Goldblum was in this movie.
Are you kidding me? You forgot that Jeff Goldblum was in this movie.
Well, I mean, I didn't sit down and say, okay, Melissa, let's go through all the people who are in this movie. Like, I didn't do that.
Wow.
It was always like the Will Smith, Bill Pullman movie to me. And now I'm like, again, please forgive me, world and Jeff Goldblum, because he is a presence in this movie.
He is the movie. Yeah. He's like, I'm just imagining, I'm hearing Jeff Goldblum and I'm going, like hearing you that you didn't know, he'd probably go, you're a lovely human being. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I forgot that Rosalind from Battlestar Galactica is in this movie.
Yes.
She
has a name.
Yes. I know she has a name.
It's Mary McDonald.
She's amazing.
She is amazing.
She's really good.
Yeah. Who else did you forget?
I also, because I did, like I said, I didn't sit down and think about every person.
Yeah, no, yeah.
So it was like this wonderful little surprise when they turned up on screen. I forgot about the boy, Will Smith, and
the boy,
his wife, their boy.
Uh-huh.
I forgot about his character totally.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
That kid's awesome.
Yeah. And I forgot about the other little, I just forgot everything. Basically. I only remembered Will Smith and aliens.
You gave us the summary of the movie. What was the summary of what you thought the movie was?
Oh, everything that I just said.
Okay. So you thought it was just Will Smith and just Bill Pullman doing all that.
I didn't sit down and think about it. I just...
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
That's why I like to rewatch movies that I haven't seen since 1996.
That's fair.
Yeah.
This movie has some of the very specific talkers. Like Jeff Goldblum has a very... The only way this could go a higher level is if Christopher Walken was in it. Has Jeff Goldblum, who has a very specific cadence of how he talks. Mary McDonnell, she actually has a very specific way she talks as well. Like, and then Judd Hirsch, the dad.
Yeah.
He, again, Randy Quaid. And then the piece de resistance is Harvey Firestein.
Oh, wow.
Who's the guy who talks like this? He's oh, no. Yeah.
What's it like when he orders McDonald's drive through? What is that like?
What's like when he starts
shouting? Can you understand him on the other side?
An egg McMuff. I can't even keep doing it. I can't imagine.
If someone pulled, you were working the drive through window and someone pulled up, let's say at Starbucks, and ordered a drink.
Yes.
Wouldn't you be concerned for them?
I would think the Frappuccino blender was on. That's what I would think was happening.
In his throat.
Yes, he'd be like, excuse me. Yeah.
Judd Hirsch was awesome. Another person that I forgot was in this movie. He's amazing. And casting him as Jeff Goldblum's dad is perfection.
It was amazing.
It's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Will Smith, too, though. This is the movie that, he was Fresh Prince of Bel-Air when this came out.
Yeah.
So this is the movie that,
And I think that's why his was the name that stuck in my mind as being in this movie, because it was his breaking out of TV.
Yeah.
And it was I don't know, I just remember thinking when we watched it, whoa, he can act.
Do you remember? Well, they do say comedy is the hardest of all acting. So he did the Fresh Prince for how many seasons? Did you remember who his co-pilot, his not co-pilot, but his pilot friend was?
Harry Connick Jr.
Did you remember that beforehand, though?
Or no, were you like, I hadn't thought about it.
Okay.
I was like, oh, yeah, that guy.
Yeah. We were, when we were watching it, we had said to, I wonder what those conversations were like, because they were both in very different aspects of the music industry.
Yes.
Hip hop. And then, what would you classify Harry Connick Jr.'s as? I don't even know.
Some sort of classic? I don't know.
It was that wave of piano and jazz almost kind of singing.
Not crooning,
Borderline crooning maybe. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, those must have been interesting conversations.
Yeah, were they looking around at everyone whoa, here we are. This is crazy.
We're just the musicians. They probably just felt better than them because they were musicians.
We're
and
actors
sing.
And musicians.
Yes, exactly. We're double threats.
And we're flying.
Fighter
pilot plane things.
Yes. So was there anything about... First off, you mentioned the little kids.
Yeah.
And I didn't know this, but this time around, as I was watching, I figured out who the little girl is. Do you know who she is?
No. When I was watching it, I was like, wow, where are they now? I always wonder that.
The thing is a lot of times, I saw this in, originally in 96. And
right,
she was whatever she was at the time, right? And so you don't connect the dots with the however many years since, right? And she... it's Mae Whitman, and you know her very well because of two roles that I'm about to say.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah. Tell me.
One is... Sorry. I'm trying to think of a line she said in the movies to get you to remember who that... You punched me in the boob.
No way.
Yeah.
That is one of the
evil exes.
Evil exes from Scott Pilgrim.
Yes, yes.
Oh my gosh, I love that line.
That little girl, her.
That's her?
That's her.
And so she was also in Arrested Development.
Correct.
Yeah, she was
bland. She was bland. And yes, exactly.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Oh, I'm so happy for her.
Isn't that wild?
Yeah, that's awesome.
That's so just...
She can say like she was the kid in Independence
She Day. Can. Anne. I know. Or she's probably trying to forget it. So sorry if I outed you, Maine.
I forgot it.
I apologize. yeah, that was just wild seeing that. And of course, I think I've seen this, you know, we definitely saw this together because we saw it in theaters, like, you know, back when we were in San Diego. But whenever Dark, you call him Dark.
Yeah.
But his name is James Duvall.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway, I always laugh every time you see him. You're like, it's Dark. You want to explain what Dark is, by the way?
It was a character he played in another movie. That's all I want to say about it. His voice is so gentle.
Yes.
It's the most, it's like a, it's even gentler than Keanu Reeves' voice, which is also
great. It's like Keanu Reeves when he's whispering.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's like how he talks all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I love it.
Imagine him at Starbucks. Excuse me. Excuse me. You gotta speak up, sweetie. Excuse me. No, I can't do Jeff Goldblum. I can't. No, I really wish I could do.
Just cool it there.
Sorry, I'm obviously very excitable when it comes to this movie. What was it like watching it now? Like, you know, it's been what, 10 years since you'd seen it? Probably 15 years before that since you'd seen it. So
yeah.
How did it feel this time around?
It was like reading a book that I haven't read in a long time where you're looking forward to like your favorite moments. Like, and yeah, so the pacing of it, because I was looking forward to different moments, I just was able to like kind of admire the pacing really good.
Okay.
I was looking forward to like the moment when Will Smith sees what's going on when he walks out on his lawn. I love that moment.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Everyone around him is freaking out and he's kind of just looking side to side until he finally looks up. And then they do this really cool shot where they follow the helicopter towards the alien ship. So it's not like he takes it in all at once. Your eyes are tracking the helicopter and then it takes you into the realm of the ship. And then it just, it just shows you its immense size. Like that scale helps you freak out as well.
Totally. It's just it is a good film. It is well constructed. It's entertaining. The actors are great.
Like, it's cool because, like, he doesn't even come in. Like, that happens, a lot happens before you even know that Will Smith is in the movie.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So that was kind of neat, too.
Yeah.
Because
it's not his movie.
Right.
No offense, Will.
Kind of was, though.
Oh!
What are some moments that you looked forward to? I have like five.
Oh my goodness. The president's speech is my favorite. Yeah. I literally watch that every once in a while. Just the speech. Cause it is that good.
Mm-hmm.
I saw in, there was a lot of contention too, like with films like this, like a lot of times it can go over budget and go longer or whatever. It was apparently... some of the studio heads wanted to like rename it or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And the director was like, or I can't remember if it was the director or producer, but they were like, no. So they got a poster made up that said Independence Day and put it outside the door to subliminally like have the studio heads see that. And then they also like wrote a lot of, you know, the speech there. He had apparently, so the story goes, they changed it to say, today we celebrate our Independence Day. Which I like to try and imagine what that speech would have been like if it wasn't the 4th of July. Because watching it again, like a lot of it is about the 4th of July. So I don't know what's going on with that story. It's very confusing.
They would have had to do a lot of rewriting.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Editing. They could have, though. If you cut strategic parts of the movie, it could have been any, you know, as long as it was warm. Could have been different part of times of the year.
What are some other parts that you look forward to?
I always look forward to Jeff Goldblum. I like the reveal moments too. Like you like the Will Smith one, that's great. I like when Jeff Goldblum is like just his whole intro to his character. You see him with his dad.
Yeah.
That's really great.
Yeah.
When he's like heads down, focused on work. And then all of a sudden he's like, oh, hey, I figured out this weird thing. And then he goes and sees what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's weird. I would think my answer would be seeing the things get blown up, but that's not it anymore.
Hmm.
When I was younger, I used to love, like, when I saw it in theaters, I think I saw it in theaters 2 or 3 times. And when I saw it, I was like, whoa, these effects are amazing. And for the record, they hold up. Like, I think they hold tremendously well. There's a few parts where you're like, eh, a little bit, but not much.
There's some green screen things that are a little...
Yeah, some of the spaceships are a little whatever, but it still has the...
I'm thinking of the dog.
The dog.
The dog jumping
In
front of the wall of flames that's going by. That was like...
That's the cheesiest part of the movie.
Yeah.
100% the cheesiest part of the movie.
That's saying a lot.
I think I said when we were watching it, prepare for the slow-mo, because it's like that is the longest scene because they just start the slow-mo like 2 minutes before the flames get there. And yeah, Vivica Fox, her hair is in slow-mo and Boomer.
Slow-mo was the one thing... Where when you're seeing a movie in the moment when it's first released, you don't mind it. And it makes sense. But then when you rewatch the movie later, it stands out.
It sure does.
Slow-mo, I don't think, holds up in a lot of cases. Like when we rewatched The Lord of the Rings, there were a lot of slow-mo parts where like, it didn't bother me when I first watched it. But now it's like... Yeah, that's a lot of slow-mo.
You know, the slow-mo that did bother me was the 17 endings. That bothered me when I saw it in theaters.
Okay,
I'm not getting sidetracked.
Okay.
So back to Independence Day.
Back to Jeff Goldblum. When his character's, I forgot this about his character, and it's a really cool part of his story arc about him wanting to, he recycles, he rides his bike, he doesn't smoke
he's a hipster.
Or drink. Like he does drink, but.
Yeah.
He's a hipster.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he kisses his dad goodbye on his cheek when he leaves the chess game. That's really sweet.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
His character, the 90s, is really what I resonate with in this movie, too, is this encapsulates the 90s so well. The technology that they utilized, like literally if the aliens had come like 5 years earlier. We would not have been able to stop them. Like, it was like this perfect, like, there's no internet that's like going around, you know, the people are still relying on like cable television for information, you know?
Right. The whole way that the aliens were defeated was the use of Morse code.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's just a great, you know how I like to talk about the time capsule of the movie?
Yeah.
Like, I would want to be a teenager now watching that movie because that world would feel so different from the world that I live in right now.
Yeah.
I really love that about the movie too.
Well, it's cool because the movie, so yeah, it was shot in the 90s and like there's nothing like futuristic about it, even though it is.
Yeah.
It's a lot of times movies like that, they'll set it in the future, but this one was like grounded in that time.
Yeah.
And then, like you said, in the technology of the time.
Oh, when that came out, the laptop that Jeff Goldblum was using and he had this like triangulation thing he put on the top of the car and it opened up. That was like James Bond like level. stuff.
But it existed, right?
Yeah, totally existed. Absolutely, yeah. The only thing that didn't exist, well, I don't know. Who knows about aliens nowadays? Maybe there is an Area 51 with a spaceship that has shields and stuff. I don't know. Maybe Data's down there too. Who knows?
That's another person I forgot was in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
He is a really great character too. And one of the scenes that I was really looking forward to was the whole like jump scare when he gets like flung up against the window.
The glass,
And I had forgotten... Because I've seen that parodied in a lot of the kids' like TV shows.
Yeah.
So I had forgotten that it wasn't, I had thought it was an alien, like the arm or something.
Oh, okay.
That it was actually Data and the alien was like speaking through
Data.
I forgot about that.
You've seen that specific dichotomy like in kids' shows or is it just like something going up against glass?
I have seen that exact scene in some of the kids' shows where like they walk up to a window.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're peering through the window and then bam, something hits the other side of the window.
Okay.
And it could be someone going, help me or whatever.
Yeah.
But it's totally that same moment.
Okay. I was thinking it was like going to the level of like something is manipulating someone to say, help me, not just like the jump scare. So, okay. The nerdiest part about that scene too.
Yeah.
Is Jane from Firefly kills Data from Star Trek. That also is super nerdy. And he does it.
I have no response to that.
He does it to save Captain Lone Star from Spaceballs.
Wait, who's...
Bill Pullman.
Oh my gosh.
So wow. The layers of nerdiness in that is just it's fantastic.
See, you know that guy from Firefly?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know him from Chuck.
Oh, right.
Yeah. What was there any other moments that you like were really looking forward to? I can think of like 10 more.
Oh, well, please go. Go ahead.
Oh, when Will Smith gets the alien, when he punches him.
Oh, when he punches him,
and
yeah.
And he's bringing it in. Yeah. And that whole scene is just awesome. I love it.
Yeah. It's
always been one of my favorites.
Yeah. And when he does the entry pass for, you know, getting into Area 51, he just shows the alien.
Yeah.
That's fun. I think I wanted to be in this movie when I saw it. Like, mm-hmm. This would have been a really fun movie to just be in. It just looks like it was fun to film.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you were in this movie, what do you think your role would have been like, or your special skill or whatever?
Oh, my special skill?
Or how you play into the story. Yeah.
I feel like I would be, like, the daughter of the crazy guy. the you know, he's yeah. like living, they live in the RV, with a group of people who live in RVs, like
Randy Quaid, like a tribe. Yeah.
And
the nomads.
I like, that's way better. Yes. Nomads, yeah. Yes. Yeah, I may have been, that might have been my character.
It just dawned on me when you said that Randy Quaid, he also had a trailer in National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
Is he Cousin Eddie?
Yes.
Oh my gosh, you're right.
And he's in an RV in both
wow.
of them. Wow. I've well, never...
He's really good at being loco.
He is. Oh yeah, he is. I mean, obviously I knew he acted in both of those films, but I did not get the RV connection. You just literally saw me make those connections just now.
Is he a Quaid? Is he like...
Yeah.
Dennis Quaid.
Dennis Quaid's brother, yeah.
Wow, mm-hmm. crazy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Did you know that originally they had it where, and you notice this in the film, when they're driving through the desert, he's in his RV and you see his red plane being dragged behind it, right? Towed behind it. Originally, they had it where he flew that plane with a bomb strapped to it, and then he flew up into the...
like his own plane.
Into the lake. Yes. They were like, nobody has any missiles, and he like straps it on. And they actually filmed it. Like you can watch the special edition version of it that has that ending.
Hmm.
It's pretty... I'm glad they switched to the other one. Everything else is the same except he's in that plane with a missile strapped to it. It's really bizarre to watch.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's crazy. Do you think Area 51 is real?
It is real.
No, not Israel.
Like, do you mean like it? I thought it like totally exists, but I think your question is there anything in it that would be?
Yes.
Yes. Because I read this Popular Mechanics article.
Yes, you did.
And it, this guy who has like high level clearance, he's coming out and saying, we need a plan.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's like these things that are surveilling nuclear, like,
yeah,
facilities. Thank you. That's the word. Mm-hmm. So I do think there's something out there.
Fishy.
I want to believe.
Well, of course you do. We grew up watching The X-Files in our formative teen years. So
yeah. I didn't. I wasn't allowed to watch it, but I watched it later as an adult.
Well, I don't know if I want to sway you on this or reaffirm what you're saying, but according to like one of the producers, the U.S. military was like, we totally want to support the film. We want to like help allow the crew to film at military bases. We want to consult the actors who have military roles. We want to help you out. And then the military learned that Area 51 references, like that it was being used in the script for the way it was being used, and they withdrew their support.
Whoa. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. That's sus right there.
It's very sus, as they say. Yeah.
Huh.
Wow.
Well, what about you? Do you believe in aliens?
Yes, I believe in aliens. Do really? I? What? What
you do?
Well, of course. Like, theoretically, if you're thinking about the entirety of all the galaxies and the universe and all that, like, there has to be other, like, intelligent life out there. So, it's developed in a couple. Anyway, yes, I believe in aliens. Okay. Do I believe they're visiting the planet? Seeming pretty likely lately.
Yeah.
Seeming pretty likely.
There's just a lot of weird activity going on right now in the air.
Yeah, totally. Like every other, you're just constantly hearing news lately.
Yeah.
So either everybody's having like mass psychosis or something, but I don't know. A lot of the excuses for what have been explanations in the past seem pretty crazy now too.
They've just like, now there's protection. There's a whistleblower protection for people who are in the military to come forward and report strange things that they've seen.
Yep.
Because up until now, there's been like a stigma attached to like saying anything.
Totally.
And there are kind of geeking out here, but
it's fine.
Like there's like, you know, in the one article that I was referencing, you know, there's a story about some pilots and what they saw.
Yeah.
And they couldn't explain it. And I've heard interviews with one of the pilots and she still doesn't have an answer as to what she saw. So.
Did she punch it in the face?
No, it was in the water.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. This was by San Diego, by the way.
Oh, well, yeah, I would think there's a couple bases there.
Yeah.
Sorry, that made me think of Will Smith again.
Yeah.
And I love when he crashes and takes down the little ship. I just love the fact that he's insulting that ship for like, your ship's all banged up. And then I'm going to light up all your friends once they get another ship. Just totally like not even talking about his ship being destroyed.
Yeah.
I just love it. This is one of my, like, probably one of my, it's definitely one of my favorite disaster movies, if not just movie in general. It's probably in my top 20.
This is the disaster movie that shows like little, like several vignettes of stories and characters and kind of knits them all together.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was the first of that kind, but that is like a way that is like a storytelling style that I enjoy.
Totally. Yeah. Yeah. And then you see them and some are done better than others too. Yeah. Sometimes it kind of gets a little thin, but this one, everything just cooked. It just was wonderful. Is there anything you would have changed about the film besides the slow-mo in that one part?
I would have loved to have the president's wife live.
Oh, that's just the... Yeah, okay. Right.
That was sad.
It was
sad. Saying goodbye to Rosalind. It's never easy.
Yeah, but then they wouldn't have that cool little, like, line thing. Pay off of that line of him being a bad liar.
Right. Yeah. Maybe that was the reason. I don't know.
This was the first time I watched it where I thought, is she actually sleeping or is she dead? Every other time I've been like, oh, she's dead. But this time I was like, well, maybe I thought wrong all the times I've watched it. And she is just sleeping because she did need her rest.
No.
I don't know. I know. Maybe I'm holding on hope. I don't know.
She would have been in the end. You would have seen her.
No. I didn't think she like lived. Oh. This time as I was watching, I was just like, he literally just came out and she could have just been tired. And then the little girl says, is mommy sleeping? And he says, yeah, she's sleeping. And he could just be emotional that she's going to die.
Okay, you just hold on to that.
I'm holding on hope. Hey, what can I say? I'm a softie.
Would you change anything?
The LA stuff was probably the weakest part of the whole movie. I probably would have changed the LA stuff a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Like it just felt, I don't know. It didn't resonate with me as well. Like, I like the Will Smith scene where it discovers it, but like the whole like recovery after the fact and driving around, I don't know. That felt like a slower part of the movie. I probably would have adjusted some of the clipping there.
Okay.
The pacing there.
Maybe for the 30th edition or something.
We could do that. We'll have Randy Quaid fly in with his plane and just pick him up and put him on the wings and strap him down and then just fly off.
Oh, that makes more sense.
Doesn't it? Makes way more sense. Yeah. Anything else you want to add before we part ways?
Oh, this was great. It was like putting on a really great old pair of jeans.
It was. Are you happy you actually knew what the movie was? Are we going to have to do this more?
It was fun. Like,
yeah.
Picking an oldie that we hadn't seen in a while.
Awesome. Well, happy 4th of July.
Thank you. That's a wrap.
That's a wrap.